legacy players in all of his favourite OPL people. So I was surprised, you know, Minky Wales wasn't thrown out there at the same time. Of course, he's retired now, but that's an interesting tactic. I mean, if you can't pick your current team, just pick your former team.
Well, speaking of Minky Wales, he actually has the most comments right now as the favourite player of the OPL. Unfortunately, not eligible because he's not currently playing in the OPL. Hopefully we can get good old Tim Wendell to get him as a substitute game.
Soul Strikes, if you can keep it that way that Minky's not playing, I will be eternally in your debt because I don't want to see Shyvana running around Summoner's Rift.
Well, we're already flying through picks and bans here for Tainted Minds as well as the Direwolves. Tainted Minds recently lost their coach in Nara, so we won't be helping them out with this one.
I just want to clarify that we didn't actually lose an error. I mean, he is still with us. He's no longer choosing to coach the organization, which, you know, has to be a big toll. I mean, he did tweet about it last night. Yep. And the other thing that it's important to note is that he was very vocal that they'd had a little bit of internet trouble during the week, so they hadn't been scrimming as much. He apologized to Legacy, and the players were also quite vocal about that on Twitter. So it seems to be a multifaceted problem in the Tainted Minds house right now. It's not just like an arrow's, you know, packed up and left back to the States or something like that. He's still there, but, you know, there seems to be some things going on.
And you can see Cake on your screen there with his recipe book, deciding what type of cake he wants to whip up today.
What is that?
The Summoner's Code. Oh.
Cake's just taking a note out of the Summoner's Code. He's a very polite summoner fish. You need to calm down, my friend. Take us through the bans.
Well, the bans coming out from the red side are the same as we normally see Camille, Rengar, and LeBlanc hitting the bench. We've seen a lot more Camille bans being last now, not being banned out quite early on into the draft phase, as Ryze, Kha'Zix, and as well as Varus. Actually going to be banned out here by Tainted Minds. They're going to get the first pick of Jace and no Varus to respond by the Direwolves. They're going to be picking up Elise for Shernfire, an actual pocket pick of Sybil when he was playing for the squad. And we have Misfortune being locked in quite early.
Yeah, and it'll be interesting to see where Shernfire and Sybil's champion pool actually overlaps because, you know, we keep hearing this, you know, Shern much more of a carry-oriented jungler, likes to be in the other jungler's face and a little bit more brawly, whereas Sybil definitely a pathing jungler, especially between top and mid lane to keep Chippies and Fantix nice and safe. I want to see whether that is also a flexible Misfortune, because we have seen, I think, a couple of MF Zyra lanes being whipped out in the NALCS.
And Zyra is still left up and is available for Direwolves to pick up, and looks like they might actually go towards it. I would like to see this, and we are going to get to see it. The prophecy is true here, Spawn. How do you do it?
I mean, I just know that Sharp checks out other regions and watches a game, so it's a pretty strong lane at the moment. I mean, Misfortune always gets strong when there is lethality or armor penetration, just because how her ult repetitively applies and does lots of nice damage, and it's a potent bully lane.
One of my favorite AD carries as well. We'll have to see how King's going to be able to use this one in this match for the Direwolves, which means their mid lane as well as their top laner have yet to be picked here. For the side of Tainted Minds, they go for the LDJ's pick, which is expected, as well as their bottom lane.
Yeah, and I want to see what they go with jungle right now, because Sheldrake is a really good Lee Sin player, in my opinion, and if he's able to pick that one up, there's some immobile carries right now. Yep. I mean, he's not going to really do great in the 1v1 jungle matchup. Elise is fine into Lee Sin, but for everything else, Sheldrake actually might be able to get some things happening around the map. I love immobile AD carries when I'm playing Lee Sin.
Well, Elise, Rek'Sai, Rengar, and Kha'Zix have been taken away. One final ban for the Direwolves. They could possibly throw it towards Sheldrake as well. Maokai was the ban of choice for Tainted Minds. Seems like they're targeting the top lane of the Direwolves.
Yeah, I reckon they'll get rid of the Poppy also, is probably my guess in regards to that. Get rid of some of the big tanks and see if they can get Praedith onto either a Nautilus if something suboptimal comes out for Chippies, or just leave him with the Jace at this stage.
I like the Olaf ban here. Olaf does do very well against immobile champions, especially with lots of crowd control coming out from the Direwolves. It does leave Lee Sin open though. Kennen is the final ban targeted towards Chippies. He's already had one game on this champion in the OPL.
Yeah, I mean, he went insane on the Kennen, so it doesn't really surprise me that they're willing to ban it away. It does leave a couple of tanks open, so they can take the tank off right now if King does choose to get lock that one in for his top laner. And this is the interesting thing about red side, is you get to see two picks, and if you pick something flexible, although that isn't flexible at all, really does allow you to counter-pick one of the solo lanes.
Porky is going to get locked in the mid lane for Fantix, a champion that has been rising in popularity in the mid lane. We expected to see a lot of Syndra, a lot of Ryze, but those two champions either banned out or not very commonly picked, actually, in the OPL.
Yeah, I mean, when you go Corki and you get Hex Shrinker, you actually survive the damage nicely. You can Volk forward, get the exhaust down as well. So Corki does fine in the matchup. Has a long-range harass to go with it as well. I mean, Corki's just a jack of all trades at the moment, and the problem with Corki is he's just so safe that when he's strong enough to be played, he's kind of insufferable as a lane opponent. He pushes incredibly well, has good trading potential, and is pretty hard to gank in the short lane. So that is, of course, where his popularity comes from. And I don't think it's any secret that his playstyle I find very frustrating.
Well, Prophet Spawn, you've predicted another pick here as Lee Sin does get locked in for shorter ace. Now I could go with the Nautilus as well.
Yeah. So really well-balanced composition. Once again, I just like Nautilus because all of the AD carries, he's going to be able to get super tanky in this composition. Doesn't have to go towards any damage items. And he just has a lovely target at the back line. I mean, click on King, hit your line, and hopefully it goes through as many members as possible before you knock him up. And Lee Sin can fly in there, and you have a dive partner to go with it.
However, Chippy looks like he wants to respond to the tank in the top lane by picking up Fiora, a champion that's commonly banned out against him.
And now I want to see if Choo Choo's actually stays with the teleport, because one thing that teams love to do is get a split pushing mid laner and give it over to the side lane as the game progresses against Fiora, because, you know, Jace is going to be able to clear out the tower absolutely fine. If he ever is in dive range, he's going to be able to respond in kind. So Chippies might not have as free roam around the map as he would have liked to just, you know, being stuck in that side lane against a tank who we can repetitively abuse.
As for now, he's sticking to the teleport, summon a spell. Fantix on the flip side has his exhaust still on Corki. Other than that, nothing too surprising from the two teams.
It gives him the advantage in the 2v2. You would say, you know, with the exhaust, the Elise as well as the Corki should take that one quite handily. But it is just a better move for later in the game. And you know that they want to run 1-3-1. You know they're going to be using the package, that they're going to be using that split-pushing Fiora. And I think that this is smart out of Sane Minds. I mean, I've spoken up how much I think that, you know, Enero in the past, who now unfortunately not with Yorg, but, you know, people like Shorter Ace and Rosie, they're really intelligent players. And I think that they got a pretty good draft here. I mean, I think Direwolves got comfort as well, but that teleport will be a curveball.
Very interesting drafts coming out from the two teams here, both with very different strategies. I'm really excited to see how Miss Fortune is going to do as an AD carry, because we haven't seen it too much
just
recently.
As I talk it up as well, he has Cleanse. So that's a spoiler alert before we get onto Summoner's Rift. So, you know, Eddie is going to be tank against Fiora in the side lane, and that's a hard one to really make work.
We've seen Fiora being able to dominate those side lanes quite a lot. Even a backdoor play coming out from one of the teams in the North American LCS, thanks to that Fiora. We have to see if we're going to see a similar performance coming into this game. Very good against tanks, especially in lane. Split pushes very effectively. It's really the team fights where Nautilus should shine.
Yeah, it certainly is. I mean, Nautilus still has some good harass potential early on in the game. Yep. I mean, he shoves quite hard as well because you max the E. Mm-hmm. But it is, you know, that 2-3 item mark where Fiora gets insufferable.
So we can potentially see the Nautilus pick up two Doron's rings later on in the game to go with that crafting potion. Similar to what 528 did on his champion. Make sure his E is powerful enough to clear the wave and has enough mana to consistently do that. As we are onto Summoners, as we're for the first match between Direwolves as well as Tainted Minds. Interestingly enough, King has gone for W level 1 on his Misfortune.
Yeah, I don't mind it. It means that you push the lane really quickly. So because you just pop W, I mean, you're able to get the passive repetitively applied by auto-attacking the backline creeps. It's good trading as well.
And it's kind of like Draven's in a sense where every time you are able to refresh your passive, it reduces the cooldown of that W. So if you use it on a wave, pretty much guarantee that your W will be permanently left up. You can already see Zara trying to get as many plants left down here as possible. Destiny stacking his passive to kick the lane off.
But generally, you want to be a little bit further up the lane. That's a better seed, and you can see that Rosie definitely recognized that, steps on it, burns his passive. But this is how you get lane control of Zyra, and this is generally why your jungler starts on the opposite side of the map. So, you know, they're not up to 50% or further with those plants and can start shoving in hard. That man on your screen is really what the talk of the town is about at the moment, though. Schoenfire, of course. First time I ever saw him play was in 2014. Was scrimming with the Direwolves a lot back then, was a huge carry jungler on things like Vi. Has, you know, been very vocal that he can change his style up, and that Korea and his time in the North American Challenger Series taught him about that. And, you know, should be vying for one of the top junglers in the region, to be honest.
Well, Direwolves happy to flex him and Sybil in their games. Sybil's been performing very well for the Direwolves recently. So we have to see if Schoenfire is going to provide the same impact that we saw Sybil have in the last few games.
I mean, I don't think it's any secret that I'm a huge fan of Sybil. I talk about his play, selfless playstyle a lot, and the fact that, you know, he's got two of the more, I guess, inflexible, in my opinion. I mean, top duo lanes, solo lanes, sorry, in the fact that, you know, Fantix likes to play a very farm-heavy style, as does Chippies, and they're both very good at it. And Sybil caters to that pretty much perfectly as far as the team goes. And I think that's where a lot of the success of Direwolves has come from in the past.
Trade up in the top lane, Praedith against Chippies. Chippies makes sure he just goes in to proc the vitals and gets out before the crowd control of Nautilus can take effect. Praedith has his shield back up, so can trade very effectively against Fiora if she does not use the riposte effectively. Meanwhile, on the mid lane though, Shenfire looking for his first gank of the OPL here. Gets some good damage down onto Choo-Choo's, but just forces him to pop a potion and head towards his turret.
I mean, blowing the cobwebs out right there, misses the cocoon pretty much point blank around the corner. Choo-Choo's had no idea he was there. However, did have the cleanse available, so probably wouldn't mean his death, but the miss means no summoner spell burnt. Good proactive play at the start of the game, I think it's fair to say. Out of Shenfire, we want to see more of that heavy ganking style.
Fantix doing a very good job in this mid lane though. Still has a single tink of his corrupting potion left. Choo-Choo's used all of his refillable pots. And has been pressuring Choo-Choo's quite nicely, especially with the extra damage Shenfire got in the top, in that mid lane. Actually, Flash being burnt in the top lane here by Praedith. He's going to try and run away from Chippies. Chippies cancels it. Oh, no.
Yeah, that was first blood actually waiting to happen. It still might be as now Shenfire looking to get in.
This time gets the cocoon, throws down the Q. Easy first blood for Shenfire. And will repel that final turret shot.
Yeah, and meanwhile, on the other side of the map, I mean, Shorter Ace has been booted out there. Looks like King is still on the hunt.
Exhausted flashes into a wall. No, Shorter Ace. No, the Direwolves get two early kills just 4 minutes into the game.
Yeah, so he tried to flash the fat part just because he doesn't have a ward hop available because he had nothing on his trinket. So a little bit unfortunate there for Shorter Ace. Oh, you just hate to see it.
And then you saw as well something you were talking about with the Corki picking over, Valkyrieing in to get the exhaust down. Something that we see a lot of Corki players don't do very frequently, which is use that exhaust actively, or proactively, I should say, to pick up kills. So good job from Fantix there to help his team out.
I mean, all of a sudden, Choo-Choo's is in deep trouble as well. This has been a great early game from Direwolves. It's what we expect to see out of the team. They're probably the best laning team in the OPL. I mean, the criticism that has been leveled at them in the past is definitely more about their macro play than their early game. They're pretty comfortable, I think it's fair to say, playing standard and being able to take over in this regard. And you can see that right now Fantix is building a CES lead and probably going to get another pretty big wave up.
Yeah, forces Choo-Choo to go back here. Shorter Ace is going to come in and try and hold this one. Cake also taking a lot of damage from the double up there in the bottom lane. Double buff! Misfortune here. Oh, that is not a pretty sight.
I mean, exactly.
Oh
right.
My goodness, Destiny, you're a monster! Just snipes him.
I mean, that's actually just disrespectful out of Cake. He saw it coming towards him. He has double summoner spells. Unless he's window shopping and Rosie's just not talking to him at all. I mean, that is an avoidable death right there. There's no other way to say it. That's just a bad play out of the Tainted Minds AD carry.
And suddenly Direwolves, 5 minutes into the game, they're 2,000 gold up. Not looking good for them at the moment.
It certainly is not. I mean, every single lane is just behind 13 CS in the bottom lane. Sure, that was a double buff given over, but definitely an avoidable kill. Top lane, I mean, Praedith is close. However, still fell down for first blood as Shenfire was able to dive in underneath the turret and snipe him away. And we already talked about the woes that's been happening in mid lane as a big CS wave is about to be picked up by Fantix. So I'd have to say Direwolves looking very comfortable right now.
They certainly are. Choo-Choo's actually looking to see if he can make his way towards the top side of the map, spotted out by a ward. Don't spot him returning though. And we'll shortly show up into this lane against Fantix. It's a good shock blast off. A little bit of poke there, but doesn't deal too much yet. Just a serrated dirk to the Jace's name. Gonna start dealing a lot more damage once he hits level 9. Maxes out the ability a little bit more. Still taking some harass in this mid lane. Fantix always been a great mid laner to watch. Choo-Choo is one of the more stable mid laners that you get to watch from time to time.
Yeah, it certainly is. I mean, Choo-Choo's, it's funny, was known for very flashy play, but ever since the, I guess, control mages has come back in, he has turned much more into a solid player, I agree. We'll see whether, you know, picking up the Jace does change that at all, as he, in the past, has loved his AD champions.
Mm-hmm. Well, we are moving back towards the top side of the map. Chippies here against Praedith. Praedith has gone for the ring start with that Corrupting Potion, so he's been able to maintain CS with Chippies here. That will slowly creep towards Chippies' favor. But Prater's doing a very good job of making sure he holds up on his own, clears out these waves, and doesn't stay within kill range of this Fiora. So Rosie actually getting locked down in the bottom lane. Thunderlords is going to pop. Good trade coming back from Cake, but still in the Direwolves' favor.
Yeah, slightly in the Direwolves' favor. I mean, they were proactively stepping up as well, so you like to see the fact that the Direwolves duo certainly happy to go toe-to-toe. That's a lot of damage. I mean, the lethality build with the Q-Max hurts. Jin can definitely trade back, however, it's not from same range, and now with the ultimate available, King can definitely force him away from that turret.
Double up already does extra damage on the second proc, and on top of that, feels even more as Cake gonna get interrupted. Sorry, King's ultimate getting interrupted, but still forces a flash from Cake. Direwolves are looking for that kill.
Yeah, I mean, maybe just not trusting in Rosie a little bit. Did flash away from the snare as well, probably would have spelt his demise, so this time just burning the summoner spell. This is becoming a pretty unsufferable lane at the moment for the Tainted Minds crew. They're down 20 CS, and it doesn't look like Destiny and King are going to let up anytime soon.
They keep threatening. There's so much range on this bottom lane, from the Zyra to the double up of the Misfortune. I already saw how much damage could do. Extra damage on the second proc, 50% more if it kills the first target.
Ooh, and a teleport has just been burnt to get back into the top lane for Prater. He wants to keep going.
Looks like he wants to just try and farm up this wave, force it back towards the turret of Chippies. He's holding well on his own right now. Prayleth has his Ninja Tabby picked up. Very important item for him to go against the Fiora. Have to see if Chippies is forced to use his teleport in response, or if he can simply walk back to lane.
I mean, I think Chippies will be happy if he wants to use teleport to get back as well. That doesn't seem like a big deal if you are the Fiora player. You can see that he does pop it up there into the top lane as everything kind of a little bit quieter after an explosive start, and it's just led to a 2,500 gold lead for the Direwolves, which at 10 minutes, definitely nothing to scoff at. However, has slowed the tempo slightly since such a, I guess, kind of scrappy start with both teams really looking to fight.
We saw Fantix pick up his first package of the game, but wasn't used to do anything. Shroomfly still positioning on the bottom side of the map, does spot out Short Race on his Lee Sin. Haven't seen too much impact from him just yet. Couple of ganks in the mid lane, or the kill top. They're just controlling the jungle so far.
And that's what you like to see out of Elise players. I mean, Elise can walk into the jungle quite successfully against Lee Sin. Get down the deep vision, you see that he's been able to proc the vision plants multiple times, and he really is playing more of a control style than a carry style right now. Has still gone for Red Smite as opposed to, you know, the wards. So is willing to fight Short Race if he has to, but is definitely playing within himself at the beginning of this game.
As we are going to see them take down the Cloud Dragon to kick things off, but in the bottom lane, King's being locked down and Kurtakor comes through. Destiny going to try and tank this up. Bullet Time comes out and Rosie's the first to fall, but they do trade one for one. Cake's going to pick up Destiny with his Kurtakor.
Yeah, exactly right. So they are able to trade back, and when you're a 30 CS deficit, I mean, trading anything is good. All of a sudden, however, Shernfire down here, no flash available.
And Cake's just going to get executed by Shernfire. Simple gank coming out from the Direwolves jungler.
And I mean, that's all the control that they have over that bottom side of the map. We've talked about it time and time again, but they were able to grab themselves a dragon with it. They're able to walk in and just pick up pretty much a free kill. So really nice execution out of Direwolves right now. You can see the bottom lane vision has 100% been a focus. And it will reward them with a first turret.
Yeah, seems like King will be able to pick this one up. Shernfire is going to run away from the gold range, and King extends his lead. Not only picking up a kill, but as well as the first turret gold all to himself.
And that's pretty selfless. I mean, that puts King up nearly 2,000 gold solo.
Ooh.
When it's a 4,000 gold lead, having half of it as the AD carry is certainly nice, as you see it on your screen.
So already picked up a shop here. Yomo's Ghostblade and Serrated Dirk straight up for the Misfortune. Cake hasn't even finished his own Yomu's Ghostblade. So that's a full item up ahead of him right now. Even picks up the Boots of Swiftness on Misfortune, which is an interesting pickup. You don't get too much attack speed as Misfortune, because these do normally help out in that regard.
I mean, maybe just looking to reposition away from Rosie, who will be probably looking to flash in on him at every chance possible.
Helps out against the Curtain Call as well as the Shock Blast too. He is waiting in the brush here. Cake going to take quite a bit of damage. Good trades coming out from King. Going to use the Yomus to dodge out the captive audience as well. Good play from the Misfortune.
Yeah, definitely. Very nicely done from King there. Actually comes out quite far into the lead. Goes and gets himself some fruit as well, so we'll be back full health. That just means that they have to back away at this stage if they're the bottom lane and risk being frozen. Not a great feeling if you are Tainted Minds, however. Direwolves definitely doing a good job of strangling it out. And maybe this is where, you know, some of the criticism comes back, because generally, if you win laning phase this hard, you probably would look to move your duo lane into the top side of the map. Instead, Direwolves definitely happy to just stay here.
They're jumping on top of King, though. He's going to take a lot of damage. Kick back into the Kerner Corn. Rosie picks up that kill nice and easy. Destiny, living with a sliver of health, almost gets one in return, but simple gank from Shorter Ace.
Yeah, it certainly is. And I mean, this time they actually back away as to see if a counter gank is coming in. Of course, Churnfire was in the area. However, can't do all that much as just one lonely Spider Lady. So we'll instead look to maybe take his skills towards mid lane. And that's the first time TM have really hit back. That was a first kick, I guess, proactive kick that we saw out of Shorter Ace. He's level 8 on the map, was able to pick up a nice kill for his 80 carry, I believe, at that stage. Maybe actually, it was a support, so Rosie grabbed that one. Maybe not the ideal target. However, it does close some of that gold.
Yep. 20 CS given back towards Cake. That big turret boost that King had. It's not going to be easy to even out. See, Chuchu's now Shock Blast combo. Puts Fantix down to half health every time he lands it.
And it was actually Carbon that said that they misread this in the meta. They didn't think Jace was going to be so high priority. You can see Tainted Mind's definitely comfortable in that regard right now as Chuchu is picking it up. Does miss the sitter as Fish throws his head back. However, we'll be able to continue to, you know, pick up some CS for himself and see if he can claw back in that margin.
Churnfire actually looking for a gank on towards Chuchu's. Bullet time comes out from King. The cleanse will come out as well. Able to avoid the gank that Churnfire threw down there.
I mean, that's double summoner spell still, however. And that means that mid lane turret all of a sudden is just wide open. No one is in the realm of being able to defend that one. They also have the package as they stream towards bottom lane. Tainted Minds need to be careful right now because that is three members strong and Shorter Ace has missed the memo.
Here they come. Rosie does have suppression available or coming up at least. Going to get jumped on here. Teleports going in towards the bottom lane. Destiny is the first target though, taking so much damage. Nautilus gets on top of the Zyra, but Chippies is here as well. Picks up the first kill. Exhaust onto the Nautilus. Praedith is trying to run away, but Chippy slides on forward into his DMs. Will not get locked down by the captive audience. The big one is not going to be enough to take him down. Just a one-for-one trade. Shorter Ace was looking to see if he can jump on towards King, but decides not to.
And I mean, that's the best you can hope for if you're Tainted Minds. It was Direwolves making the proactive play. They got down there with the package, but really not able to pick up all that much. It's a one-for-one trade, and actually with Chuchu's down here, little bit of priority given over to the Direwolves, Tainted Minds, as they look to push in.
Cake taking so much damage from Fantix there, not afraid to go toe-to-toe against him, even with the Jace waiting nearby.
No, Corgi, what can I say? He does it all. He has good burst damage, good poke damage.
How'd you like the champion?
Let's take another look at it. I mean, he uses the package in here to split up the fight nicely. You know, that was a, I guess, little bit of a misread as he went on to Rosie. And Praetus got into the back line nicely, so he's able to get the kill there, the execute. And honestly, was lucky to not fall down to Chippy, who unfortunately, you know, little bit low on mana. And nearly the turnaround, to be honest. King overextended a little bit. Shorter Ace wanted back in. Chuchu's wasn't really in range. But as I said, if you're 3,000 gold down at only 15 minutes into this one and you gave away such a big advantage early game, I mean, you take the small victories. And that looked like just marginally, Tainted Minds got out ahead.
Didn't see how much time there was left on that package, but would have liked to see Fantix hold on to that a bit longer because they did have the wraparound already and didn't do much damage to Rosie.
I mean, I think what he was hoping is to get something like a rocket to just break the spell shield and then be able to knock Rosie onto the other side of it. Obviously, that was not to be. As Shorter Ace is here, does not get it.
Goes in, he's going to get locked down and take it down. Interesting choice, because that's just a Cloud Dragon that they've given up.
You know, I have a different word. I'm going to go with a little bit silly, that choice there. Probably didn't need to dive into the pit for the dragon.
So there is a good thing about this Cloud Dragon, is they have Misfortune on the team. You can already see running around at about 500 movement speed, thanks to Strut and the Cloud Dragon, with Yomu's on top of that. As well as all the Serenity of Dirt passives coming through from Lethality build. Runs fairly fast for him.
I agree. But I mean, I haven't won many games off movement speed alone. so, you know, whilst I agree with you, going to be able to, you know, get down sound some rotations a little bit easier. Still isn't definitely, you know, the be all and end all of the game.
Surprise attack from Praedith. Chippy does not care. Fight me.
He kind of does care. I mean, that's a quarter of his health that went down. And Praedith is not being bullied around all that much at the moment, to be honest. Still a tanky man. you can see, just clears out waves. This is what you like to see out of your Nautilus. I mean, he maxes E first, then he goes into his W. He's just a big brick. Even if you push into him, he holds waves off the turret, which is why I like him more than Maokai into this matchup. And it's very hard to get anything going. Meanwhile, the siege begins in this lane.
They start the show here with the curtain call, but hits absolutely no one. Rosie going to get chunked down by Schoenfire here. King comes back in. Bullet time goes through. Everyone from Tatermine scatter. And a big shock blast will come back to deter Destiny and Schoenfire from chasing on through, and they save their turret.
And you just see how much damage the Misfortune ultimate does. And every single time, unless Rosie can interrupt it, they just have to get the heck out of Dodge. Ooh, a little bit of a trap here.
Shorter Ace has been caught out. Thunderlords comes out. King trying to chase on through, deterred by the little chickens. We're attacking in there. Schoenfire wants to collapse. Shorter Ace will get out safely.
Yep, so in the end, it was actually Shorter Ace who was trapped. Really nice read out of Direwolves. Good vision control. You can actually see that Schoenfire is put pretty high priority as Shorter Ace actually flashes.
Scared of the Zyra?
Away from Destiny. I mean, giving the respect it's due, I like it.
I've seen Destiny play Zyra quite a bit in solo queue recently. He's very good with those max range snares and max range Qs. Definitely understands the champion very well. Top side of the map, Praedith is still just sticking to chippies, making sure he stays nice and even here. Has not fallen to him. Even picks up a Sheen, looking for an Iceborne Gauntlet as his next item.
Yeah, it means you can trade back a little bit better. I just want to go back to, you know, looking at the vision control right now. You can see that the Direwolves definitely want to play around mid lane because they've got those control wards out there, especially focusing on the top side of the map, although there was one just cleared out. And there's also a ward behind both, I guess, flanking areas. One just expired to the left of the lane, and there's also one on the top side of red buff. So. For Tainted Minds. So really right now, Tainted Minds have got the vision set up that they can just continue to play what is a pretty heavy mid lane focus. Right now, however, King maybe it overextended. They would look to collapse on him. And you see that those wards just afford you the luxury of being able to back away.
Tentacle getting popped here. Fantic's actually taking quite a bit of damage from Choo-Choo's. And will not connect with him. As Destiny and Schoenfire split the damage from those bullets. Able to get back to safety, but Tainted Minds will again look to try and siege mid lane while Fantix recalls. No Paku's for him to skip straight back to the mid lane. But Schoenfire looks like he wants to go for a fight. He's right behind him.
Yeah, he certainly is. I mean, that's very deep for a full AP.
Oh my goodness, the bullet time is massive there coming out from King. Shorter Ace will trade one for one, but he's very low here. Has to get the heck out of Dodge.
I mean, in one more time, he's just not back far enough. I mean, where is he supposed to go? He doesn't have a ward.
Run!
Where?
I don't know.
Schoenfire right there. Corki's got the package. I mean, you either hope he misses you, or you die, Fish. That's as soon as you stop, you're just dead.
Don't stop. Direwolves going to use that time to try and siege up the mid lane. That's going to fall. Mantix picks that one up. Big combo from Destiny and King. Bullet time into the grafting roots thingy from Zyra.
Mm-hmm.
Can't do words.
Certainly one. Able to grab a nice E there onto multiple members. And you know, with that, the complete collapse of Tainted Minds, honestly. They're now down 7,000 gold. We've seen extended laning phase in the top lane. A little bit more grouping out of the mid lane at this stage of the game. But all of it's just been Direwolves. I mean, the bottom lane skirmish, slightly in TM's favor. But there's a reason that there's 6,500 gold up at this stage. And haven't really looked all that pressured from the poke of TM.
Yeah, very big items coming out from the Direwolves as well. Chippies has the Ravenous Hydra in the top lane. You can already see Schoenfire's got two major penetration items with his jungling item picked up as well. Rapid Fire Cannon, nice and early from Fantix. I know you like this build out of Corki's.
Yeah, it certainly is. I mean, it just gives you so much poke damage to be able to execute on. You can see it's about a 1,400 gold right now lead for Schoenfire right now. There's a little bit of a fight going to break out.
Fantix is going to get locked down by Praedith, and you're going to see Cake destroyed in the back line. So they trade one for one, but that's a lot of ultimates used by Tainted Minds to take down the mid laner from the Direwolves. Choo-Choo's running straight towards Schoenfire. He uses the rappel, gets knocked back. Here goes Shorter Ace, gets the kick kill. It's now a 3-on-4 if Direwolves want to try and start this one, but they still have Chippy split pushing.
Yeah, he certainly does. Chippies is still in the top lane, so they have to send Praedith back. Ulti still available for MF.
Oh, Shorter Ace taking so much damage. Narrowly avoids it. Now it's going to be Choo-Choo's who jumps back in. He kills your boy King and flashes away from it.
Yeah, he certainly does. And now all of a sudden, Destiny in trouble as well.
Chippies is down here looking to try and chase down the low health members. Gets two, gets three. Triple kill coming out for Chippies.
And all that was that Chippies had the teleport and Praedith had the respect the split pushing that was going to happen. I mean, the Direwolves turn that around one more time. You think the Tainted Minds finally get the pick they're looking for, but over aggression, I mean, that is Choo-Choo's flashing underneath turret to try and pick up a single kill. Mm-hmm. And they make them pay. They actually grow the gold lead off that pick.
They certainly have. Direwolves looking very strong here. And Tainted Minds, they got two nice and early picks, but execution just not on point there. King really good to open up, very confident with his bullet time there, trying to clear the wave and damage anyone who threatened to dive on him.
And I mean, ultimately, he saved the turret because as you can see here, they funnel in against Destiny, and able to get the exhaust out. That's massive damage. Thought he was going to fall down to the little void monsters, but they swapped over to Chippies, who, you know, just ran through and torched the rest of the team. He's now 4-0-1.
Yeah, he's got his Black Cleaver and a BF sword to boot now, looking for that nice and early Bloodthirster. And surprisingly, no Black Cleaver coming out for King here. Opting to go for pure lethality. Still a great build coming out from this Fortune.
I mean, it's still early days. You expect him to go towards potentially a Black Cleaver if he feels he has the luxury for it. Potentially, you know, something like a Last Whisper item as well. I like the Cleaver purely for the CDR. I mean, the other stats you can get elsewhere, as you can see, the flat lethality right now is certainly very high. And unfortunately, with losing that team fight right now, Tainted Minds kind of no longer can hold Chippies underneath that turret, although Fantix. Uh-oh.
Lockdown again. It seems like he can be caught one more time here by Tainted Minds. Choo Choo, so caught in the rain of bullets and bullet time. But they locked out Shernfire. He's the next one to fall. King's flashing forward to pick up Choo Choo's. Almost dies in the process. And now Shorter Ace is on the hunt with Cake. He does have the Urge of Night to get him back to safety. Chippies will be able to take down a turret for the two picks.
I mean, he also killed the top laner.
Praetus dead.
Yeah, Praetus no longer in this world. Just got turret over, and that's what I said. Unfortunately, what really, I guess, is bad for Tainted Minds right now is the fact that they just gave three kills over to Chippies, and now there's no one that can go with him in the split pushing battle. He's just going to have complete reign over the map, and even though they look like they're going okay,
hello,
as Destiny picks up another kill, as far as the map control goes, they're falling down very hard in the split pushing battle.
Yeah, casually Destiny just decides he wants to take out Cake.
Just has everything left available. Gets the dangerous game to also keep him alive.
Gets the heal out of Cake as well to add insult to injury.
I mean, Cake just needs to flash one of the Grasping Roots if he really wants to live. That would be the first step towards not getting blown up by the support.
Decides he didn't need it there. He actually did. And now Direwolves grouping up towards the Baron. Ping's actually going out from Tainted Minds. At least he's on the bottom side of the map. This could be a rush from the Direwolves.
Yeah, and it's going to be. I mean, they have so much damage at this stage of the game. Four damage threats on the Baron. Shernfire going to be able to pick this one up easily for his squad, and nothing Tainted Minds can do about it because, as you said, Lee Sin was on the bottom side of the map. That's a great read.
Simple, easy, smart play from the Direwolves. Tainted Minds, no way for them to react to this. They'll get a consolation prize off mid lane. They can rush it down fast enough. That's going to be easy for Choo-Choo to destroy.
All right, and we've seen Direwolves in this position before. They have a Baron buff. They have a superior split push.
Hello.
They have absolutely everything in their favor.
King!
And King's just face checked the brush for no reason.
Buddy. You can see Cake laughing on his screen. That's a good way to stall out a Baron.
It certainly is. I mean, now they don't have an AD carry. They're going to send Chippies down bottom lane, but when you've lost position on the map, you can't really overextend for that farm in case there's multiple members there. And that's what I was going to go back to. I mean, really, Direwolves at this stage need to figure out how they're going to cleanly close out these games because 26 minutes in, they've looked so dominant, and yet they've just given away silly little advantages that you shouldn't have to.
I take back everything I said about Triple Cloud helping out Misfortune there. Just makes it easier for King to run straight into his doom.
Too quick.
Too fast, too furious.
Because now they're actually looking to catch out Chippies, potentially.
Or is he's waiting in the wings. They've got three members down here. He does have Shernfire and Destiny close behind him.
They're also bringing three members down from Direwolves, as you just pointed out. So it's a risky play to make, nonetheless. And Chippies does the right thing, honestly. Now they're going to get priority back in the mid lane. I mean, if you TM, you can't afford to brush camp forever. That's kind of the weakness of the brush camp strat. As lanes are just going to get shoved in. And at a stage in this game, even though King doesn't have his Baron buff, it's not going to matter because they've still got three members in that group.
Uh-oh, they might have done it again. They locked down Shirtfire. He's going to get taken down straight away. Praetiff, though, taking so much damage to return. Destiny goes on a killing spree with that one. They trade two for one, but now Cake's in trouble. Chippy just slides in right behind him. And they're going to take down three members of Tainted Minds.
I mean, that's what happens when you don't grab the Misfortune. Unfortunately, she just torches your whole team, and that's a much better read coming out of the Direwolves. They understand it's a brush gank. They take more than one member there, and they're able to finally get the kills.
Here comes Shorter Race though, with Choo Choo's looking to try and get more. Fantix taking a lot of damage. He is forced to flash away as a Shock Blast is almost enough to take down the Corki. Jippies will try and see if he can pick up a consolation prize here, which will be the turret.
Yeah, it certainly will be. I mean, it's a pretty good consolation prize. It's going to force them about 13,500 gold into the lead. And the whole map right now is in Direwolves palms. You can see that a couple of sneaky camps are coming out from Tainted Minds. This is what happens when you play tankless one more time. I mean, it's just so easy to blow up one member. But at the same time, you know, they've got everything they want. They've got all the big items picked up. The map is opened up. It's only 28 minutes into the game. And just want to go back to the fact that they got Chippies onto the superior split pusher. And he's been able to take over.
He's 6-0-1 right now, Chippies. Doing a great job here. Now, Fantix has really stepped up to the plate in this match as well. It's really good to watch him perform well in the mid lane. He's always a very solid player, also a flashy one at times. Tainted Minds still trying to hold on here. 28 minutes already. Baron buff's going to expire soon. Direwolves were able to get turrets from it, but no inhibitors taken down yet. Tainted Minds still hold on to all of those. They've already lost their top lane inhibitor turret, though.
I mean, at the same time, Direwolves are kind of doing everything they need to do right now. They've got triple Drake. Another one is about to come up in 15 seconds. That sets them off if they ever do get past 35 minutes to be able to take a very big Elder. Baron's going to respawn soon, and they, once again, can just position Chippies in that bottom lane. You can see that next objective is the Dragon.
Stop!
So they're putting Chippies top. As soon as it's Baron, they'll be rotating in back bottom.
Tainted Minds have a thing for these bushes, though. Spawner is always waiting for control on top of them. I think they've proven the fool me once, shame on me. Fool me twice, shame on you already. Don't think Direwolves is going to fall for it a third time. So they take down the fourth dragon of the game. Mountain
I mean,
dragon picked up.
Same time, you kind of just have to throw one member to the wolves if you are Direwolf. You just, you know.
No! They're going to find them again from the brushes they strike! As Tainted Minds just destroy the Direwolves! King is the last man standing! We'll be able to sidestep everything with his massive movement speed, but Chippies might be able to take it a hit for this one.
Yeah, it certainly should be able to, and really, what is Tainted Minds getting out of these brush cats?
Oh, no.
They're just losing more priority around the map. Chippies looks like he's probably going to go for an execute into the fountain.
Ooh. Sidesteps it. Actually, now trying to run away.
Yeah,
he's going
to
do some
dough.
He's going around the map, flashes away. There's a turret here, but there's minions to help him out. He's just going to slide right away from this one. Now, King, you better run, but that's a lot of damage.
Oh, nearly gets stunned up. I mean, he's still sprinting around the map. You see how quick he is. And honestly.
Oh, no. Flank. Here comes the Nautilus. Direwolves might be in trouble. Praetus right behind him. Chippies, don't go that way, buddy. From the brushes, again, Tainted Minds are going to strike as they lock down the Fiora. King watches helplessly as Chippies get shut down. Oh, my goodness.
Praetus is laughing his head off. I mean, right now, you can see this is frustrating the Direwolves because, honestly, brush camp after brush camp is just coming up King. And honestly, it's not much. Just stop going into the brushes. I mean, just push down the lanes. Even if they come from behind you, as long as you have King positioned at the back of your squad, you outdamage them so severely at this stage of the game. But they've fallen for the bait a couple of times.
Oh, my goodness. Here it is again. Third
this.
Time.
This is as a full squad. They actually know they're in there.
Ooh.
And that's just a huge knock-up and really nice exhaust. And as you can see, King just can't get positioned to be able to set up for the ulti.
Almost died as well. Curtain call didn't quite clip him to slow him down. I have a feeling Tainted Minds going to do this one again, though. Yep.
I mean, they can't really because Baron's back available, so they're not going to wait near a brush because otherwise Direwolves just take Baron. At a stage of the game, they have to figure out how to win a fair 5v5 fight.
Well, they did get top lane inhibitor going for the Direwolves here, so that will slowly push back. Praetus is forced to deal with that one. No teleport available for the Nautilus. That gives Chippies free time to go bottom lane. He has teleport.
And you can see that this time they've decided that a pit is more effective. See whether they can actually.
Here they go! They're going from the wolf camp! Oh, from the darkness, Tainamines will strike because Churnfire has to repel to get back to safety, but the Insurgency Spider's forced to flash. What is this?
Yeah, so they're able to pick up another pick. It means it will delay the Baron. However, maybe Chippies can get something done on the bottom lane. Probably going to send Choo Choos down there to try and deal with him because we've seen that the Nautilus has been relatively ineffective.
Yep.
And Tainted Minds are starting to get items. This game actually gets pretty scary for the Direwolves because honestly, when you have two big tanks in the Lee Sin as well as the Nautilus, if it ever gets to 5v5 territory, you're going to be positioned for pretty good success. At the same time, I mean, the Zyra is still a huge threat. Mm-hmm. Mel'Zahar getting towards that stage as well. And this is one of those games that you just hate to be an AD carry. I know we have lots of them on the map, pretty much four if you count Corki and Jace, but you're in kill range from 100% health this game.
Even from the supports. I mean, Zyra was one of the first supports to ever pick up Liandry's as well as the Rylai's. And this is back before support items were a big thing. Now we're seeing Brokman pick it up here. Direwolves trying to rush a Baron. This is going to be easy for them. Tainted Minds nowhere close to respond to this. That's going to be good enough.
Yeah, I mean, it has to be. As I said, they have the advantage when they're able to come out of the brushes, but unfortunately, none around that Baron pit.
They should have just picked Ivan.
Maybe they'll look for a collapse onto bottom lane and see if they can pick up Chippies instead. Or I feel like this should actually still be a relatively easy clean out. I mean, 33 minutes in.
Or are they? Oh, they were waiting. 33 minutes in. Yes, Direwolves are really far ahead. 11,000 gold up spawn.
This should still just be, you know, marching Baron down two lanes and being able to pick it up. Although now Chippies definitely is overextended and there are members here.
Three members of the Tainted Mind Squad looking to try and collapse on him. Four, including Choo Choo's as he jumps straight on top of the carry. Now Tainted Mind's looking for a fight of their own. Shorter race, trying to collapse. Here comes the curtain call. Cake wants to slow them down. Churnfire taking quite a bit of damage from these bullets. Here comes the rappel, trying to get back to safety. Bullet time comes out, they're tearing them away, but Choo Choo snipes them off. Hook barely misses from Perry. The King has the blue suede shoes to avoid all the shots come out for Tainted Minds. But again, two big picks for TM.
This is supposed to be the easy part of the game for the Direwolves. I mean, when you have a look at it, they've got an inhib down. There's creeps inside the base. They need to play with a little bit more of patience. Chippies overextends. There's no mid lane punish yet available. So they pick him up. They pick up Churnfire in the mid lane. 2-5-3. This is not the debut the Direwolf jungler was hoping for. His team is so drastically far ahead. But another frustrating closeout for the Direwolves.
And it's exactly what you were talking about on the OPL podcast. I mean, Direwolves win their lane nice and strong, but it just seems like once they have to group up, if they can't use their superior mechanics to bully you out in the lane to win the game, it's just really difficult for them to play a good macro play.
Also, don't get me wrong. This is like some well-cooked Gouda out of the Tainted Minds squad. I mean, this is some of the cheesiest stuff I've ever seen in a professional game.
I mean,
brush camp after brush camp. Fnatic would be like a single tier is being shed right now for a Fnatic roster of the past.
Well, Tainted Minds trying to rush back because Elder Dragon is going to spawn. That would be Baron Elder.
Yeah. Well, what can you do, though? I mean, you still can't fight them in a fair 5v5, so they're going to see it another objective.
Ooh, that's a difficult one to give up here, especially with Baron buff already live in the Direwolves.
At the same time, I mean, if they're just all damage threats and you one-shot them because you have an 8-2-3 Jace, who's an absolute monster at this stage of the game. No real GAs being picked up. I mean, Shurnfire's gone towards the Void Staff. I really disagree with the build coming out of the jungler. You've just seen him be picked off time and time again. You can have as much damage as you want if you're just going to instantly die in the team fight.
I mean, you have to think if Tainted Minds win another team fight here, their morale is going to soar through the roof. They're already laughing on camera. They know they've pulled off three, almost four cheesy plays. They're still trying.
Waiting around the corner.
And if you're Direwolves, I mean, this game was done at 20.
This game was done earlier. This game was done at 14 minutes. I mean, they absolutely destroyed the bottom lane.
They should not be 36 minutes into the Smash, but they are. Their morale must be sinking slightly. They just want this one to be over.
Well, I don't think it's really a morale crusher because ultimately they're still in the driving seat and they know that. Ooh. I think it's more of the fact that they just will be getting a little bit frustrated as this game keeps going. At the same time, they're about to pick up three inhibitors in the top lane.
They're going
to
try and force a fight here because they know that inhibitor's going to go down. Shurnfire is likely to target. He has to rappel up. Praetus jumped in. Bullet time's going to come out. Choo Choo's incredibly low. That shreds the Nautilus. Chippies is just left in the top lane alone. He's going to take down a free inhibitor. It seems like all the inhibitors are going to fall here. Tainted Minds left to defend their base. trying to lock down Chippies a little bit too quick for them.
And you saw how short work they made of Praetor just because of all the damage that comes out of this squad. Not able to get onto the Misfortune. Oh my goodness!
That's so much damage. They snipe one. Shurnfire's taken down again, walking all over these traps. Tainted Minds get a little bit of confidence. They've lost almost all their base, but it's an even 4-on-4 now if they can get on top of Direwolves.
It certainly is, and I mean, still with the Outer Drake King.
Almost dead there, Shorter Ace, getting jumped on by Chippies. He gets kicked back, so much damage onto this guy. Lots of lockdown towards Fantix, he's gonna fall. Choo Choo's lays down the pain. Misfortune will get it with the Make It Rain. He's still chasing, Destiny's gone. Double kill for Choo Choo's. And Tainamites, they're still holding on. Look at Rosie, he can't believe what's happening.
I don't think anyone can believe what's happening. They were able to clean up the whole base, and yet again, they look for the team fight as opposed to walking the Kareeps into the base fish. I mean, Tainted Minds hit back everything on the line right now. They're able to shove the creeps out for a little while longer. Direwolves, 78,000 gold, 38 minutes into this one. They've got four dragons. They've taken two Baron buffs. Somehow they're behind in kills, and they're just all still building full damage. They've got one GA and a chain vest. They're the only two defensive items in this whole kit.
Whew. If you just keep hitting these shock blast combos, especially now, he should have full items when he heads back to base.
He's a monster. I mean, I understand why Carbon said he is a bay of his now. I mean, Choo Choo's is popping off this game.
Big bay. Chippy's now trying to push the mid lane down. Praetor's done a good job of pushing up the top lane. They don't have to worry about that crashing onto the Nexus for some time. But no inhibitor turrets are left for Tainted Minds. They have to take fight after fight here. Luckily enough for them, Elder Dragon should be down now and no Baron buff available. It's coming up in a minute 30. That should be where we see the next big fight if Direwolves don't just try and press something here. Lots of breathing room for Tainted Minds, and they're doing it again.
I mean, right now, all you... Ultimate, here you go, call. Fish.
Shurnfire, he's going to have to be forced to repel away. Shorter Ace, looking to try and collapse. Shurnfire forced to flash. Pray they're trying to run. Going to take a lot of damage, but look at Chippies. He will get locked down. Tries to turn it around. There's a big bullet time from King. Shorter Ace is going to fall next. One by one, Tainted Minds are going to have to run for the hills. And it's only Cake left standing. And Direwolves might just get their just desserts here.
Much better execution out of the Direwolves. They bring Chippies in early with the teleport. Looks like Fantix is going to be able to pick up the last kill. Clean Ace, and they will take the game in about 40 minutes.
He gets his cake, he eats it as well. Direwolves will be able to pick up game one of this best of three series, but if you're the squad, not going to be too happy about how they close that one out. I mean, their face says it all right now, Spawn.
It really was still never in doubt. They were up so far from like 14 minutes into this game. However, you can tell that they wanted that one to be a clean victory. And you feel like, as I said, Tainted Minds just stuck to the game plan, which seemed to be get the team fights we're looking for, make sure that we're laying our CDC correctly, and we're going to be able to pick up kills. And that's what happened.
I mean, despite the loss, Tainted Minds definitely have to have good morale after that game, knowing that 10,000 gold behind was still fighting back.
Yes and no. I mean, they're still competitive players. Losing a game sucks.
Yes.
And they still lost it in, like, as I said, pretty convincing fashion. I mean, they picked up, I think, two turrets all game, mm-hmm. if you're the Tainted Mind organization. They didn't get a dragon. They didn't get a baron. They really didn't have a sniff in the whole thing. So, yeah, sure, they got a couple of cute team fights. They made the game very entertaining, but I think that still sucks if you're Tainted Minds. It's just about, you know, where do they go from here? Because I think that their team comp was pretty smart, and if they stayed even, those team fights start hurting Direwolves a lot.
It certainly was, and it looked like they were going to be able to try and upset the Direwolves there, but they still fight back strong, clean out the game about 40 minutes into it. To break down that game a little bit more, let's throw it back to Hingers and the rest of the analysts.
Thank you very much, Fish and Spawn. Well, there we have it. Direwolves 1-0 over Tainted Minds in this series. But Mendrix, but Carbon. Obviously a late, a long game, and perhaps not only, I mean, Spawn was saying they might not be happy with the way they won, but you know, you got to think they're the architects of their own demise there, right? Building all these damage items, Carbon?
Yeah, I don't know. To be honest, they're pretty lucky that Chippy's picked up that Quadra at mid because he pretty much solo carried that game. His pressure in the side lane utterly destroyed Tainted Minds. There was nothing really that they could ever do to deal with him, so they did the only other thing they could do, which is try and engage on the four, which they did brilliantly, I must say, a number of times. But you can't help but wonder how that game might have gone if Chippies didn't pick up a Quadra kill.
Mendrix, when you look at this team picking up all those damage items, does this continue that narrative of them perhaps playing in a disrespectful way, do you think?
Oh, absolutely. And the reason behind that is that they could have actually just had, you know, for a little bit of extra damage reductions onto themselves, made it so those team fights would be a little bit more convincing, especially when Tatum Mines were doing those cheeky little bush hides on the side, sort of channeling Fnatic at that point in time. And the thing that I really want to touch on there is that it really illustrates what we expected from them. We expected them to have a strong early laning phase and then to have weak macro play. And throughout the entire time, that long, drawn-out battle was because of that weak macro play.
All right, well, let's take a look at the pick spans, the draft phase of this game. He's bringing it up on your screen. Now, the big thing for Tatum Mines is obviously they're playing without a coach. Cake was there reading the Summoner's Code. So let me get your read on this draft, Carbon, because... on the Direwolf side, we're seeing Misfortune AD, which Inero kind of predicted yesterday.
Yeah, very clever, I think. Very nice pickup from Direwolves because you take, first you take Zyra, and then you take away the counter to Zyra, which is MF, and play it AD. And with the lethality changes, her kit does incredible amount of damage right now. Mm-hmm. So I think a very smart takeaway there in counter to the Malzahar. Malzahar Jhin, a great lane in its own right, but MF Zyra is very difficult to beat.
Mm-hmm. And what I like about how Tainted Minds play that out is that they turn to what are the strengths of their bot lane or what the utility they had picked. They've got a Nautilus, they've got themselves a Malzahar, and they turned it into a pick composition, and we saw them illustrating that as it got towards those late games. That's why Direwolves had such a tough time closing it out, just, you know, having a little bit of a giggle after each time they managed to get a pick just on the side there. It was really great to see.
I also want to point out one of the big reasons I think that that game went on for so long is the Jace pick from Tainted Minds.
I think
Choo-Choo's played a fantastic game, but the itemization that you were touching on earlier with them all building damage meant that this lethality Jace, you could see every time he hit a Q, the team fight was over. Direwolves had to pack it up and go home because they would get chunked to half, they would get chunked to one quarter. Like their itemization made it so easy for Choo Choo to have a huge impact.
Well, the other thing we were trying to predict going into this game was whether or not Schoenfire, the new jungler for the Direwolves, was going to step up into that role. He's replacing Sybil, who's quite a well-respected jungler in the scene. He's had six deaths. He's copped six deaths in this first game.
Yep.
How did you feel he went as the resident jungler on the desk, Carbon?
I don't think that was the debut he would have wanted.
Sure.
I think he ended the game 2-6-4 or something like
that,
is a poor score. But his early game was pretty good. His pathing early was quite good. He propped up his bot lane a little bit, gave him a bit of pressure. He managed to pick up a kill where Chippy's cancelled his auto for the solo, which was a bit sad for Chippy, as I'm sure he'll be upset that he didn't get the solo kill.
Solo carry, man.
But Shen managed to clean that up. He also put a little bit of pressure on mid when he unfortunately missed the cocoon, but was otherwise a good gank. Not the debut I think he would have wanted, but serviceable.
Would you describe it as dominating, Mendrix?
No.
Okay.
Absolutely not dominating. I mean, we expected him to come into that dominating, and he never really did. It was he had a few good flashy plays, especially, you know, in the Dragon Pit when they did manage to pick up a Air Drake. He immediately had a really snap, quick cocoon, which just landed straight onto Shoulder Ace, and he was pretty much gone afterwards.
But buy one, get one free.
Yeah, buy one, get one free, I think, as Carbon would like to describe it. And end of the day, though, it wasn't a dominating performance. And to really have that sort of interview afterwards and not deliver... Let's see what he can do in the next game.
All right, well, let's take a look at this team in the mid lane. I think it's the first tower. And Mendrix, what do you think is the particular thing you want to take away from this game?
So, as you can see, Chuchu's doing a great job jumping in there, forcing the fights. But Tatum Mines overextend just a little bit, and immediately Chippies comes and pops off. And it sets up the pace for the rest of the game. Chippies, as Carbon was saying before, it was able to put immense amounts of lane pressure afterwards. And because he was able to do that, he just was able to allow the Direwolves to win the rest of the game.
Yeah, I just want to point out that just before that, what we didn't see in the replay was that Tainted Minds actually just killed, I think, three Direwolves for nothing. And they were at a 7k deficit at that point, purely through the lane phase.
So
a massive comeback team fight out of Tainted Minds. Choo-Choo's went for the dive, which I don't think was that bad a play. I think MF had a shutdown gold bonus at the time, so not that bad. Maybe he lives and you know, he saves the game or whatever. But a great Zyra ult out of Destiny with a nice TP follow-up into the Quadra. I don't want to say sealed the game, but made it pretty difficult.
All right. Well, the other thing we were all very much enjoying towards the end of this game was drawing it out with the Brushfire surprise ganks. So let's take a look at one of these replays where, well, Carbon, I mean, this is
That is actually a fantastic Nautilus ult. I mean, he flashed it to get all four people knocked up. I mean, they did this. I mean, the score is 15 to 9. I think they ended up like 20 to something. I mean, they did this four or five times in a row. Direwolf showing no respect or no understanding for the potential bush cheese. You know, I think it was maybe Fish who said it on the cusps. You know, fool me once. Shame on you, fool me twice, shame on me. Well, they got fooled about five or six times that game.
Another thing to point out without actually coming into it is they started, you know, firing rockets randomly into rushes. They had to completely change the gameplay because of the amount of times that Tender Mines did that to them. And towards the end of it, I saw them sort of finally starting to get those blue trinkets, you know, after it happened the third time. So it made them rethink their plan. But it was definitely a great, entertaining show.
All right. Well, we also saw the reaction cams there of the Tainted Mind players very much enjoying having a little giggle there as they camped and cheesed from the brush. That is game one. Direwolves are up 1-0 in the series. We'll be back with game two right after this.